All right, we've talked about the basics of Turing machines, where in a Turing machine, we have a set of states, an alphabet sigma, an alphabet for the tape gamma, a start state Q0, delta, which is a function that goes from Q and gamma to Q cross gamma cross LR, and we have the accept state and the reject state, where what the Turing machine does is it gets the input, and it can walk across the input and eventually decide to go to the accept state or the reject state, at which point the function returns. Sorry, the machine returns. Now, in our discussion of languages so far, or of models of computation, we always had two different ways of thinking about things. For instance, we had the DFAs, but we also had the regular expressions. We had the context-free grammars, and we had the PDAs. Where in this column we have the machines, and in this one we had the languages or the expressions. The idea is that what the machines do is they take one string and they say yes or no to it. And what the languages slash expressions do is they just describe the entire language by itself. So which one of these are Turing machines? Well, clearly Turing machines are over here in this category. So what is the analog of a Turing machine? Sorry, what is the Turing machine analog of something like a regular expression? Something that describes the entire language itself. The idea is something called an enumerator. An enumerator is very similar to a Turing machine. How it works is you have Q. You have sigma, you have gamma, you have Q0, you have delta that goes from Q cross gamma, arrow Q cross gamma cross LR. But now instead of QA and QR, you have one state which we call QP. And the idea of QP is called the printing state. The intuition is that a Turing machine is like a little box that you send in a book, a piece of paper, and it reads the letters on it and it says yes or no to it. What an enumerator is, it's a box that you turn on, you click the button, it turns on, and what it does is it just prints out pieces of paper. And every single piece of paper it prints out is a string that's in the language. Rather than accepting something and telling you whether or not it's in the language or not, instead, it starts printing out the things that are in the language. And the way that it works is we say that W is inside of the language of some enumerator E. We're saying that this is some enumerator E. If we start with epsilon Q0 epsilon, we can run and eventually get to some X, and we're in state QP, and then there's some string W on the right-hand side after it. Now notice that the enumerator doesn't stop after printing it. Every time it visits the QP state, whatever is after the head, that is one of the strings in the language, and then it keeps going. So for instance, what it could do is it could generate one thing and then generate something more, and then generate something more. So for example, we could make an enumerator like this, where we start, okay, and then what we're going to do is we're going to, that's a way to do this. What we'll do is we're going to ignore the, we're going to expect the input to be blank, and then we're going to write a zero and move to the left, and then that's going to be QP. And so now we're going to print out zero. So we just printed zero. Great. Then the next thing that we're going to do is now that we're in QP, what we're going to do is let me simplify this. I didn't really think of this example before I started, so sorry. All right, so we're going to come in to QP. Since we start in QP, that means that epsilon is in the language. And then what we're going to do is we're going to loop, and we're going to expect to see a blank, and then we're going to write a zero and move to the left. What this corresponds to is this is like zero star, because it just keeps printing strings that have a lot more and more and more zeros. So that's an example of a little simple enumerator. So like usual, whenever we so first of all, regular expressions are a really convenient way to think about regular languages. In fact, people often think primarily about regular languages via regular expressions. They don't really think about DFAs. Similarly, people primarily care about context-free grammars. People care less about PDAs. Basically, people kind of prefer these ways of thinking about languages. Turing machines, though, not really. No one really cares about enumerators. They're necessary. I mean, they're not necessary, but they're useful to like fill out the symmetry of this diagram. But they don't really like speak to us. We don't really think about programs as working this way. I mean, certainly there are some programs where you turn them on and they like produce some data. That's kind of what a printer, that's kind of what an enumerator is. But they're definitely a different way of thinking about what a computation is supposed to be for. But like usual, we proved, remember, we proved that DFAs and regular expressions are equivalent to one another. We proved that PDAs and context-free grammars are equivalent to one another. So we should also try to prove that Turing machines and enumerators are equivalent to each other. So let's talk about how to do that. So suppose I had a Turing decider, and I wanted an enumerator. How could I do that? How could I take a decider and turn it into an enumerator? Remember, what's a decider? It's something where you send it in, you send in data. Sorry, yeah, you send in data and it says yes or no. But an enumerator, what it does is it just, you turn it on and it starts printing stuff. So what could it do? What the enumerator is going to do is the enumerator will try all strings in lexicographic order. And if the decider says yes, then it prints them. Notice that I'm like really waving my hands here about how this is going to work. I'm not going to like draw a diagram for how it's going to work, but we're just going to talk about the idea. Okay, so the idea is that we can take something that says yes or no by trying every single string from shortest to longest, and then if it says yes to it, then we print it out, and if it says no to it, we skip that one. Now notice that this is okay because the decider will always say yes or no, so we won't ever accidentally run forever. So that's great. All right, now what about a recognizer? What if we had a recognizer? How could we use a recognizer to produce an enumerator? Now I'm going to elaborate on this in the future, but essentially the thing that makes a recognizer different is that it might loop forever. Given that it might loop forever, that means that we can't use this strategy, because what if we try to run on 0 and it loops, but it wasn't going to loop on 0, 0? Well, if we do them all in order, then that means it will be stuck and will never produce things. So essentially, a recognizer version of enumerator is one that doesn't have any sort of rhyme or reason to why it prints things out. It might even print things out twice. So the recognized version of the enumerator, basically what it's going to do is it's going to try all strings in parallel. And why do I say in parallel? The idea is that if it tries them in parallel, then if any one of them will loop forever, well then we'll just like not worry about that one, and then we'll choose one of the other ones when it finally says, when it is finally accepted, and then we'll print that one out. Now what if we want to go in the other direction? What if we have an enumerator and we want to get a recognizer? So what that means is that you gave me a box that's going to print out every string in the language. And what I need to do is I need to take that box and make a machine that will take in a string and say yes or no to it. Well, here's the way that I do it. I just turn on the enumerator, it starts printing stuff, and eventually, maybe it prints the thing that you gave me. So I press the box, it starts printing things, and then I'm looking at everything that comes out and say, does this match what I got? Does this match what I got? And if it does, I say yes. So what I'll say here is I'll say check the output. Now notice that I have no idea when to stop paying attention to the output, because the output is going to come in any random order. So that means I can never say no. So I never say no. Therefore, I am not a decider, I'm a recognizer. But what if we wanted to get a decider? How could we do that? Well, how we could do that is that imagine we put a constraint that the enumeration was in order. And when I say in order, what I mean by that is in the lexicographic order that we produced up there. Well, then that means I could still check the output. But when could I say no? You would say no if something got printed that was bigger. If something bigger was printed. So what I mean by that is that suppose that you gave me a string that was 10 characters long, and I looked at every string that came out of the enumerator, and they come out in order. So some of length 0 come out, some of length 1, some of length 3, 4, 5, 6. But then something comes out that's of length 11. And I know that the enumerator prints them out in order, and I'm looking for something of length 10, and it didn't come out, therefore it must have not been accepted. So then we can say no. So this is a very sort of hand-waving argument about how to possibly turn enumerators into deciders. But notice that it uses all sorts of like ideas that are not really ideas related to Turing machines about moving around characters and whatnot. It talks about things like doing things in parallel or simulating one decider while inside of another Turing machine. These are very complicated ideas, and we really need to justify that this is possible. Now, how did we justify things like this in the past with other machine models? For example, we started with DFAs, right? And then what we did is we created NFAs. And NFAs allowed us to do more things than DFAs did, at least in terms of expressiveness. They allowed us to talk about non-determinism, i.e. doing things in parallel. They allowed us to talk about ignoring the input and skipping things. They were more expressive. But then we proved that they were actually equivalent. And then once we proved that they were equivalent, that allowed us to show that DFAs were equivalent to regular expressions. We want to do the same thing for Turing machines and enumerators. We have Turing machines, and we have enumerators. But the only way that we can show that they're equivalent is if we make Turing machines more expressive. Now, it is difficult to make Turing machines more expressive, because they have a lot more sort of going on for them. Because they're already quite low level. Here's what we're going to do. We're going to build a network of extensions to Turing machines, which are called Turing machine variants. Okay? The way that that's going to work is that we're going to have our normal Turing machines, and we're going to show that they are equivalent to something called a multi-tape Turing machine. Then those multi-tape Turing machines, they are going to be equivalent to non-deterministic Turing machines. And non-deterministic Turing machines are then going to be very powerful, because that we're going to be able to do lots of other things. Like, in particular, one of the things that we're going to be able to do is we're going to prove that multi-tape Turing machines give us union and intersection. We're going to show that non-deterministic Turing machines, they give us concatenation and function application, which is both interpretations of the circ symbol. So basically, we kind of think of this as we extend what Turing machines can do, we're going to greatly improve the expressiveness of what we can say with Turing machines, and then it's going to be easier to justify these kinds of explanations for why they're similar to enumerators. But now, how are we going to do this? What I want to do is I want to set up the structure of how we're going to do that. So what we want to do, so we want an extension of Turing machines. Now, the way that we did this in the past with DFAs and NFAs is we proved a very big theorem. We proved a very big theorem that for all things in some input space, there exists something in some output space where the meanings were exactly the same. Okay? So what that means is that we had some value A in our input space, and when we called the meaning function, we got back some answer that we'll just call X. And then we have some other thing in B space, and this is the compiler, and it has its own meaning that goes exactly to the same place. Okay? Now, notice that the reason that this is a very big theorem because the meanings have to perfectly align with one another. And that means that we can't have sort of like internal differences between the objects. There is a theory, you can look up a Galois connection or a bisimulation. And this is another way of thinking about problems like this, where we loosen the constraints a little bit. Rather than saying that the meanings are identical, instead what we do is we do the following. We say that for all A inside of the input, there exists a B inside of the output, where when we evaluate in the input language A, we get something which is similar to evaluating in the output something in the B. So as a picture, what does that look like? As a picture, that looks like we have an A, and we evaluate that, and we get back little a. We have a B, and when we evaluate that, sorry, a big B, we get back a little b, and then we can take this little b, and you can kind of think of it as we can decompile it into the A, and this one we can compile into the B. And in particular, the number of steps involved may be different. Like maybe it takes many steps of B to get a single step of A. By loosening the theorem, by saying that there might be a function that allows us to port from one to the other, and by making it so there can be many steps here, we make it so that the theorem applies to more situations. And if it applies to more situations, then that means that we're sort of freer in writing a proof about it. So let's look at a little tiny example of kind of a stupid case of doing this. Imagine that what I want to do is I want to extend Turing machines with a stay action. So what do I mean by with a stay action? The normal delta function says that we go from q cross gamma arrow q cross gamma left right. Hold on 1 second. In our new thing, delta with stay, which we'll write as ds, we have q cross gamma arrow q cross gamma left, right, and then a new thing called stay. And here's what it means. When delta of qi a equals qj bs, when it's the stay action, that means that if we used to have u before us, we're in the qi state, we're looking at an a, and then we see a v, then we want to change this to u, we're in the qj state, there's a b in front of us, and then a v. So that is what the S action means. So the X action means that we stay in the same spot, but we do a different thing. Okay, so how does this idea of the Galois connection, the bisimulation, apply to this? Well, what we want to do is we want to compile machines that have stay actions into machines that don't. Now, the way that we're going to describe doing this is we're going to say, well, what would happen if we had this rule right here? Meaning that our Turing machine is supposed to go from U, QI, AV, and it's supposed to go in one single step to U, QJ, BV. And this is in the stay side. So stay is the input. Now what I need to do is I need to turn this into some other kind of Turing machine, a normal Turing machine. And normal Turing machines cannot do this in one step. It's not possible for a Turing machine to do that in one step because it has to move left or right always. So what that means is that we're going to compile this, okay, so that when we're in state U, QI, AV, we do something. And then after doing that, then we're going to go to U, QJ, BV. And then this we can compile back. In this case, the decompilation is trivial because they are actually identical. So what is this intermediate state going to look like? Well, the intermediate state is going to look like this. We're going to go U, B, and then this new special thing, which we're going to call Q, J, star, V. Okay? And here's the rule. We're going to say that whenever delta QI A equals QJ BS, we're going to translate that to saying that delta QI A is going to equal instead QJ star B right. Okay? Then what we're going to do is we're going to say that for all QJ inside of Q, delta of QJ star little gamma, and we'll say for all QJ inside of Q and for all little gamma inside of big gamma is going to equal QJ gamma left, sorry. Gamma left. So the idea here is that every time there's a single stay action inside of our stay Turing machine, we're going to change that so it's going to go to a different state. It's going to go to the QJ star state. Then for all of the states inside of the machine, so imagine that there were 10 states before, now there's going to be 20. So there's going to be X and X star, A and A star. And the A star state always reads anything and writes that same thing but moves left. Okay? So if we apply these two rules, this compile function, what it does is it changes the machine, it changes the delta function in these two ways. It adds this rule, it adds these states, and so on. Now this new transformed version has the exact same behavior as the stay put machine, except that it takes one extra step to do everything. This is an example of making an extension to Turing machines. It's kind of a boring extension to Turing machines, but it's the kind of thing that we're going to be doing a lot more of in the future. Because what we're going to do is we're going to go through a whole bunch of different variants of Turing machines, and we're going to see how they make Turing machines more expressive, so we can slowly build up our capability to do more things with them. So that's a good amount for today, so I guess we'll stop now.